IoT technology in general. In part two, I will talk about how IoT or Internet of Things can be beneficial in Indian agriculture. And finally, in part three, I shall discuss a few case studies in India and abroad, along with some possible applications of IoT. Now, what is IoT or what is the definition of IoT? We know that IoT focuses on connecting things to a computer network. Connecting things to a computer network. What are the things? What can be the things? Things can be any object like a sensor, an actuator, a machine. And what can be a computer network? The computer network can be an internet, the internet, or it can be a local network. And sometimes, in some cases, data can be uploaded to a cloud service for analysis and decision support system. And in an IoT system, what we normally do, we normally monitor. We normally, after monitoring the process parameters, we try to control the process parameters, and finally we analyze. Why we analyze? It is not simply acquiring data and control devices, but we try to gain useful insights from the data generated by the devices. The insight we gained can be used to tune parameters for better performance, better control, and more productivity at a, obviously at a lesser cost. Now, Internet of Things has some differences from traditional internet. What are those? Now, first point is who creates the content. In traditional internet, human creates the content, whereas In an IoT systems, machines generates the data or the content. Machines mean sensors. Sensors at different points of the field, or it can be embodied on a person. It can be anywhere. It can be embodied on a machine. They are generating data or contents. Second point is, how is the content consumed? In traditional internet, it is done upon request. We want to know something, we give a request on the internet and find out that document, and we study that document. Whereas in IoT system, we push information. The sensor pushes the information to the server or gateway or a control computer, and actions are triggered after analysis of data. And what is the value we get from traditional internet? Traditional internet answers our questions. We want to know something, we want to do something, it answers some questions and give us the opportunity to do that. But in an IoT system, the focus is to monitor and to control some devices for better operation by gaining some insight of the system out of the data generated by the sensors. One more thing is there, machine-to-machine communication. Machine-to-machine communication means, suppose in a field, in an agriculture field, there are two autonomous tractors is operating in an agriculture field. Now, these autonomous tractors may communicate with each other independently of any human interaction. So it is machine to machine communication. Now I talked about data. So data is the first layer of information. What data means? Data means some values, some numerical values generated from the sensors. It has no practical value in themselves. From these values, we cannot interpret anything. So I need to convert, or we need to convert data from data to information, where we have extracted some meaning out of the data. such as suppose we are measuring temperature by a sensor, temperature sensors. So what we know that these amount of temperature means this is a low temperature, this amount of temperature means this is high temperature, and this is the appropriate values. So some knowledge when we gather from the data, or some information we extract from the data, that is information layer. After that, from information we need to convert the data into the knowledge layer. Knowledge layer means here we take some decision making. Suppose we are trying to monitor the fertility level of soil in an agriculture field. Now, if we understand that the soil fertility level is low, what we do? We apply some fertilizer. So that is the decision we take, that soil fertility level is low, apply fertilizer. So we gathered some knowledge that if fertility is low, we have to apply some fertilizer. If it is high, we need not apply. Finally, it comes the intelligence layer. What is that? Intelligence layer means that we have put the knowledge and wisdom of a farmer or an agricultural scientist into our decision making process. Okay. So suppose there is lack of fertilizer in the field. What type of lacking is happening? That is being analyzed by automatically by the computer or the computing system, and an experienced farmer's wisdom will apply here, that what exact amount of which fertilizer need to be put in that particular field of land. So we have to convert data to a intelligent layer. Here comes the term called artificial intelligence. So nowadays, whenever I talk about IoT, it is not simply IoT or Internet of Things. Always, artificial intelligence is tagged with these IoT things. So we call it IoT AI. So in the following slides, whenever I talk about IoT, it is not simply IoT. It is the combination of AI with IoT, artificial intelligence, or IoT AI. Now, little bit of genesis of IoT. So we can classify into four phases. Phase one is the connectivity phase. We can call it digitized access. When computers got connected, email came. We can exchange information through emails. Then came the web browser and the search engine. So that using web browser and search engine, we can we could extract information from the huge data repository or information repository across the global network that is called internet. So that was the first phase. After that, what happened? In phase two, network economy happened. That is digitized business. We got e-commerce, we got supply chain management digitally, and collaboration between enterprises through internet. In phase three, there is a huge leap happened, and we got immersive experience and technologies. We got mobility. Now internet came on our palm top, that is on mobile devices. We got cloud services. We got a lot of audio and video applications across internet. We also have some social applications. So that was phase three. And finally, today's era, it is the era of Internet of Things. Now everything got connected, or people are trying to connect everything. Any process, any data, any object or thing, any machine, even people are getting connected. So the tagline or the slogan is connect the unconnected. So we are now in an era of Internet of Things, or some people call it Internet of Everything also. The components of IoT, when I discuss, there are two major components. Number one is sensors. We need to capture the parameters from a field or from a device or from a machine or from something. So from the physical world, real physical world or real world physical environment, we need to sense parameters, physical parameters. We are doing this through sensors. After sensing, we are trying to measure, measuring the value of the parameter. And after getting the parameter, after analyzing, we need to control the parameters in an useful way. So we need to act. We are acting through actuators. Actuators are controlled by digital electrical signals. Now, if you just see the right-hand side figure, there I am showing a sample IoT application framework. The sky color things are the sensor nodes. Sensor nodes are nothing but it can be a sensor, any kind of sensor, or it can be an actuator also. It is deployed at the site itself. And the green color things, you can call it a gateway. Sensors or actuators need to communicate with this gateway through some wired or some wireless links. Normally, the links are wireless links, low power, low range wireless links. And what is a gateway? Gateway has the capability of storing the sensor data temporarily for some time, as well as in some cases, this gateway can also process data. Now, suppose in a field, you need to take certain action immediately or almost in real time. In real time, if you want to transfer the captured data to a server or to a cloud, process there, and then some action will be transmitted to the gateway and then to the actuator, that will take a long time. That cannot be the response cannot be a real time response. So for real time responses, in cases where real time responses are required, the gateway is given some processing capability, minimum processing capability, so that it can process the data also, and it can, after analyzing the data, it can take certain decisions also, which are required in real time. So these kind of gateways are called edge devices, okay, because it is at the edge of the network. From this gateway, we can transfer data to some distance locations, some mother gateway, you can tell these brown ones, through another network link. Again, this can be a wired link or a wireless link. And finally, the backhaul communication link, and the blue colored link, that is the link. This should be a very, very strong link with high bandwidth and high data rate, high speed link. These links transfer the entire data to a server or to internet, wherever. In my first slide, I said that your network could be internet, your network could be a local network also. So as per, depending upon your application, you can transfer your data to your server. So component wise, I have sensors, I have actuators, I have gateway. Connectivity is very important. There can be 3, 4, 5 types of connectivity. Connectivity from the nodes, sensor nodes to the nearest gateway, from the gateway to the mother gateways, and from the mother gateways to the server. And server or cloud is another very important component of any IoT device, because depending upon the requirement or processing requirement of your application, you can get your server. It can be a single server, or it can be a cloud service also. As you can see from this diagram, that that any operation, any IoT operation is very very similar to how a human operation happens. It is has high resemblance. Like we have sensors, we have five kind of sensors in human cases: sense of smell, sense of hearing, sense of sight, sense of taste, sense of touch. These senses, and then electrical pulses are transmitted to the brain. Brain analyzes the signal sensed by the human sensors, and then we have actuators like hand and leg. Brain sends signals to our hand or leg to act. Suppose in case of a mosquito bite, it is a sense of touch, and it goes to your brain. Brain analyzes and it sends a signal to your hand to kill the particular mosquito, and your hand does that. So this is the entire operation. Similarly, in an IoT system, we sense using electronic sensors, a CPU or a server that analyzes or process the data to do some meaningful, to take some meaningful action, and using some actuators or implements, we do the thing. So it is very similar to human perception system. Now I have shown here some of the communication technologies or network technologies which are very very important in case of any IoT implementation. You can see it depends on the range. If it is very, the range is very less, the required range, I mean from the gateway to the sensor node is very in at a very very less range, that is it is within some centimeters, then you can go for Bluetooth. If it is up to 5 kilometers, we have technologies like Zigbee, like Thread, like Z-Wave. We have wireless LAN. We have 802.11a, b, g, different IEEE standards are there. We have, if it is more than that, we have LoRa, we have Sigfox, we have WiFi, which is also called 6LoWPAN. Zigbee NAN is another application, and finally we have some in the cellular domain, that is LTE, GSM, GPRS. We also have in the license band NB-IoT. So you can cover in from this diagram, you can see that using different technologies, you can cover up to some 80-90 kilometers. Okay, so even at a remote field, you can apply your IoT applications. But remember one thing: for any IoT applications, you may not get power. So the sensor nodes and the gateway has to be battery operated in most of the cases where you are not getting power, or it has to be operated through some solar power, using solar power. So power is very very important in case of any IoT implementation. Now let's come to the part two of our discussion, that is the features of Indian agriculture and how it can be improved using IoT applications. We know you are mostly I have seen that mostly the participants are from the agriculture background, so you all know the problems of Indian agriculture. I have very little knowledge on this, but whatever I have seen, I have documented here, the major problem is small and fragmented land holdings, soil degradation due to excessive use of fertilizers. I guess this is a very very true. And in Indian scenario, always the output or the outcome, it depends upon external factors like weather. By weather I am meaning rainfall, water resources, whether I have proper irrigation facilities nearby, like I am having a river or a canal or an irrigation canal in the vicinity of my land. And we are helpless mostly in cases of pest and disease attacks, because when a farmer notices that his farm field is infected by a pest or a disease, in most of the cases it is too late, and nothing can be done. So his entire produce is lost in field. Lack of mechanization, very, very little mechanization has happened in India, although I have studied that the ICR institutes, they are developing along with universities, agricultural universities, they are developing various mechanical equipments and trying to push to help the farmers. Environment pollution is another problem we are facing, because we don't know how much, whenever there is any pest or disease attack, a farmer is not sure how much or in what amount he has to spray his pesticide. So he thinks that the bigger amount is safer for him, and he just sprays any amount of pesticide, and finally it pollutes the water, the soil, everything. And it is also very much, it can be disastrous for the person who is spraying the pesticide also. Another problem we have seen in recent past, from CEDAC, we did one project with FCI, Food Corporation of India, for their storage. So that time we found that storage facility is also very, very inadequate, as well as not proper in India. Marketing is a problem, and as I said, very slow adoption of technology, particularly the information communication technology and computer technology in the field of agriculture. So the bottom line is, agriculture is not at all a lucrative profession. People are going away from agriculture. There is shortage of farmer. What I heard, that only the old and middle-aged people, they are into farming. The younger generation are moving to cities for some other work. There is also shortage of labor, because agriculture labor, they are also migrating to cities for better wages. Environment pollution, already I have mentioned. When we are polluting environment, we are our food safety is also compromised, and health hazards for the workers or the agricultural workers. Now let us discuss how the information or technology or the IoT can improve the agriculture system. Mostly, sometimes we call it precision farming or smart agriculture. Sometimes it is called agriculture 4. Sometimes it is called digital agriculture. Whatever it is a technology-enabled approach to farming management that observes, measures, and analyzes the needs of individual fields and crops. In short, through IoT, we can do the right thing in right place at right time. Right thing, right place, right time means through IoT system, what we can achieve. We can find out the variability of a particular agricultural field. Obviously, it should be bigger, whatever we see, more bigger than that. We can club, say, 4 or 5 fields, and we can find out the variability in that field. and we can apply our resources judiciously based on the requirement of the field in right proportion. To do this, we require there are three components in IoT. Number one is capture. To find out the variability, we need to capture the information from the soil, from the plants, and also sometimes the weather information. So we need to capture data. Second one is we need to analyze data. And finally, after analyzing, we need to act. So the diagram shows that from a crop field, using sensors, we are capturing the data. After capturing the data, we are putting some AI. Already I have mentioned what AI does. And finally, we took some decision and act according to the decision. AI is very important. AI plays a very, very important role in such precision farming applications. Now, what benefits can we achieve from precision farming? We can increase productivity, soil degradation we can prevent, reduction of chemical application, pesticide application, fertilizer application, and if we can reduce these application of chemicals, the amount of chemicals, what we achieve? We achieve less use of application and preventing the pollution. Efficient use of water. This is very, very important. I have studied that 70% of the water usage of our country is in agriculture only. And out of this, 50 to 60% is not required. It's not at all required. We just put water for farming. We don't know how much is required. So, if we can efficiently use the water in agriculture, we can save water, because you all know that water is very, very precious. In coming days, we have to save water. It improves quality, reduces cost of production. I wish it reduced the cost of production, and reduction in volatility and risk. I said that in many cases, our Indian farmers, they are relying upon the act of God on rainfall and on pest attack. They don't know what to do. So that kind of volatility and risk will be reduced. Yield estimation, that is very, very important, because how much yield you are going to get from your crop, based on that yield, you can plan accordingly. How much to store, how much to sell, how much to keep for your own consumption, all the things. So that is very, very important. So yield estimation can be done, and it can also help in crop insurance assessment, which is the requirement nowadays. So using IoT, the entire socio-economic status of the farmer can be changed. What are the solutions available in Indian scenario or in foreign countries? You can see tractor are being used extensively in Indian agriculture, and nowadays I have also seen electric tractors also. Seeder, I hope it is being used. I guess it is being used. Transplanter, I have seen transplanter for paddy cultivation, for paddy transplantation. The number of usage or the percentage of usage, I have no idea. Mechanical harvester, I have seen very much it is in use. Controlled irrigation or smart irrigation, here and there some application, mostly in research level, it is being used. Drones, people are trying drones extensively for spraying, for disease and pest infestation, detection of disease and pest infestation. Autonomous tractors, driverless autonomous tractors. It is a reality nowadays in foreign countries, but I don't know whether our Indian farmers will be able to use this because of its exorbitant cost. And finally, a wireless sensor network or WSN network, where we can put field sensors at different place. We can divide the farm field into some grids, and in each of the grid we can put some sensors to measure soil characteristics, to measure environmental data, to measure plant condition, plant health, plant growth, and capturing all this data to a central server and analyze the data and then act according to each of the grids. Okay, so that is wireless sensor network, which is one of the major applications of IoT. But problem with this kind of implementation is the cost, because if you divide your entire field into smaller grids, then you need to put huge number of sensors, and you know, sensors, whenever you increase the number, it is going to add cost. So we need to do something very cleverly, so that we can balance the cost of the implementation also. If you see the agricultural processes, the first process is soil preparation, then sowing of seeds, growth monitoring of the growth of the plants at different stages, crop health monitoring, whether they are okay or not, whether they are diseased or some pest attack happens. Spraying of fertilizer is important, when and how much to spray. Disease detection is important. Spraying of pesticide is important. Controlled spraying of pesticide. Weed removal is another application. Irrigation, how much to irrigate, what is the amount of water to be given. Harvesting is another activity. Storage, marketing, all of these activities we can apply ICT technologies, or in particular IoT technologies, to improve the processes. Now, what are the tools we are having? Sensor actuators, already I have said. WSN technology, that is one. Wireless sensor network technology is one. Computer, mobile, internet, and cloud service, these are very, very important for the AI application. And whenever you are going for a WSN technology, you need to generate map. You need to generate a precise map of your field, of the agricultural fields on which you are putting your IoT application. For this, geographic information system is one technology or tool we are having. For positioning, we need to know the position of each of the grid or each of the sensors deployed at the field. For this, we need to use GPS devices. You know, nowadays GPS devices are very, very cheap. They are available on our mobile also. But the problem with such GPS is they are not very precise. They can be inaccurate up to 3 meter to 30 meter. So the alternative is to use differential GPS, that is called DGPS, that gives much, much better accuracy. UAV, unmanned aerial vehicle or drone, is another technology, particularly suitable to detect the plant diseases and controlled spraying of pesticides. People are trying here and there. Lot of applications are being developed UAV technologies. Autonomous field vehicles. This is one technology which I'll talk later on this. autonomous field vehicles means driverless tractor sort of thing, which can go to the field and do some agricultural processes depending upon the commands of the farmer or the operator. And micro level weather prediction. Micro level weather prediction. If we can predict the weather, we can assess the weather and predict the weather to micro level or to fold level. You will be happy to note that CEDAC, in association with Bidsa Agricultural University, has developed this kind of application, micro level weather prediction application, on a 4 kilometer by 4 kilometer grid, which can give you prediction up to panchayat level. 4 kilometer by 4 kilometer is panchayat level, and that is this app has been, or what do you call these application have been developed for the entire Jharkhand state. So Bidsa Agricultural University was our partner in this development. Application wise, there can be three kinds of application using WSN or wireless sensor network. Number one, it can help you in designing a smart irrigation system. It can help you a smart fertilization system, depending on the requirement of your fertilizer at different points of your field, you can apply fertilizer accordingly. So WSN can help you in doing that. And early disease detection and pest control is very, very important, because we know that disease and pest destroys a huge amount of crop every year in our country. Now let us come to the third part of our presentation, that is some case studies along with some of the possible applications. Out of these case studies, we'll talk about one case study of a foreign country, that is in Japan also. Now this is one application a few years back CEDAC developed for the tea plantation, which is the decision support system framework for tea plantation. It is a WSN application or IoT application, where we put different kind of sensors on the tea plantation field to get the soil condition as well as many other parameters. Like the parameters we measured are soil moisture and pH, ambient and soil temperature, humidity, solar radiation, leaf moisture, and we also put a few cameras on the field, solar powered cameras on the field, to detect insect invasion and disease. Now, whenever you want to make the grids very small, you need to put huge number of sensors, and that will add cost to your implementation, and that may become realistic in under Indian agriculture scenario. So what we did, we tried to put minimum number of on-field sensors, and we developed one soil sensing kit, where we put all the sensors whichever we have put onto the field. So what a person need to do on a regular interval, it may be 3 days, it may be 7 days, it may be 15 days also, he has to roam around the field and take the measurements from the field. It is online because we have put a GPS and we have provided a GIS map along with the input features, so that directly from the sensor, you put the soil sensor onto the soil on a particular grid, it will capture the position of the GPS location of that particular point, and it feeds the data directly to your mobile or to your laptop, the sensor data, and it will go to your server on the map. So apart from the field sensors which were giving results regular intervals 24/7, we provisioned another thing, that is a soil sensing kit which people can take measurements at different points, and combining all this data the central server can take decisions. The decision support system is built upon all this gathered data. So we have two implementations or two deployment in this Tea Research Association Tokelau Jorhat. They were our collaborator, the domain expert in this research, and we implemented or deployed one in their field, their tea garden, and another deployment was there in a private tea garden in Assam. So we made two deployments of such devices. They are still are in use. This is a very, very probable application. And now, when we talk about agriculture, animal husbandry also falls under agriculture. Any kind of animal husbandry, it can be dairy, it can be poultry, it can be fishery, it can be piggery, it can be goatery, anything. Now, for dairy application, we have conceived one project with NDRI, National Dairy Research Institute, Kollani, where we are trying to monitor the cattle 24/7, all individual cattle, by putting wireless network sensors or IoT sensors on the collar of the cattle. You see that these type of sensors can be put on the using a collar on the cattle, or it can be put on the ears, or sometimes it can be put on the feet of the cattle. What these sensors will do, these sensors will monitor the health parameters of the individual cattle, because we know that any disease, if we can detect at an early stage, it will prevent huge production loss. So what are the parameters we are trying to measure here? We are trying to measure the body temperature, the pulse rate, the rumination rate, the lameness or activities of the cattle. You'll be surprised to hear that the rumination rate, a single parameter, rumination rate, if we can measure properly, that can give you enough information or on detection of early occurrence of any sort of disease. Whenever a cow is diseased or going to be diseased, the rumination rate falls drastically. So if we can only monitor the rumination rate, we can have an indication that a individual cow or a particular cow is going to be diseased, and it has to be treated by a veterinary doctor. So those kind of information we can provide to the dairy manager, and thus we can save a huge amount of production loss. So in this kind of architecture, the architecture is like this: we'll put sensors on the collars of all individual cows in a dairy farm, and we'll put some gateways here and there. The gateways will collect the information, and it will transfer the information to the central server, where in association of the domain experts of NDRI will develop the decision support application. Now we are in the process of building the proof of concept on this. Our engineers have already started designing the proof of concept on this. Next important one application can be a poultry, where we can monitor the environment parameters like temperature, relative humidity, carbon dioxide, ammonia, atmospheric pressure, airflow, light intensity, etc., etc., of a poultry farm. And we can model the stress on the birds based on these parameters, and we can decide on acting. Like whenever the temperature is increased, we can start the fan. Whenever ammonia is increased, we can start the exhaust fan likewise. So that can save a huge mortality rate of the poultry birds. And another application we are trying to do here, that is from the vocalization of the poultry birds, we are trying to assess the health and the growth rate of the birds. So this study has been done in foreign countries. People are trying this. We have planned to do here in our application also. This project we have developed with Directorate of Poultry Research, Hyderabad. In fishery, we have developed one project with C3 Barakpur, that is Central Indian Fishery Research Institute, Barakpur, where we have measuring the water temperature, the conductivity of water level, dissolved oxygen, oxidation reduction potential, water pH, etc., etc., and trying to find out or model the fish behavior or the stress on the fishes on these parameters. Already we have deployed, the POC has already been made and deployment has already been done in C3 Barakpur, and we are now fetching or gathering the data and analyzing the data to build up the model on the stress on fish. Now let us see a Japanese case study. This is the last case study I am telling you.
पकड़ बंद कर दे बेटा, बंद कर।
Am I audible now? Am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Can I see your my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, let me repeat. I understood that I was mute for some time. So, I start again from the Japanese case study. Lodging is a major problem in rice cultivation in Japan, and because of lodging, the mechanical harvesters faces a lot of problem in harvesting, and yield is also reduced. And the Japanese scientists found that excessive is use of nitrogen fertilizer is the main cause of lodging in Japan. Now, how this lodging effect can be neutralized? They thought that if I can apply nitrogen at a variable rate, that is wherever how much is required, that I will find out and I will apply that amount only in that particular region. So that can solve the lodging problem. Again, they found that electrical conductivity of soil has a very, very strong correlation with the nitrogen content in soil. Next observation, what they found, that whenever they are trying to measure the soil conductivity using using some electrical conductivity sensor, the measurement accuracy, it depends on the depth of the topsoil. Means if the depth of the topsoil is more, it has to be balanced with some standard value, so it needs to be corrected. Okay, so for this, along with the measurement of electrical conductivity, you need to measure the topsoil depth also. Now, if I break my entire field into smaller grades, and I need to put these so many amount of electrical conductivity sensors and topsoil measurement, topsoil depth measurement sensors, you can estimate the huge amount of cost is required, is involved in this. So what they thought, that whenever the transplantation of rice they need to do, along with the transplantation, they will measure the electrical conductivity and topsoil depth, as well as they will apply the required fertilizer then and there. So simultaneously, along with mechanized transplantation, they will measure the electrical conductivity, they will analyze the amount required in that particular plot of land, and they will apply that much amount of nitrogen in that particular field of land. For this, what they did, I am showing you. They used a transplanter for this, for transplantation of the paddy plants. There they put a DGPS antenna. I said that DGPS is nothing but differential GPS, which gives you better accuracy than the normal GPS in positioning. And they put two ultrasonic sensors at the two sides, two front sides of the transplanter, to measure the topsoil depth. The height of the of both of these ultrasonic sensors is 850 millimeter from the base. Now, what an ultrasonic sensor does, it measures range, right? Now, whenever the transplanter is in field for transplantation of the rice seedlings, it is measuring, both of them are measuring the height of the top soil. Okay, the average of these two measurements they have taken. So the problem of topsoil depth measurement is over. They can measure it on the go, and they also know at which position or which location of the field they had measured the topsoil depth. Second part, what they need to do, they need to measure the electrical conductivity of the soil. For this, they used some stainless steel probes to measure the electrical conductivity, and they mounted it on the two of the front wells. They mounted two such probes, and they applied a 1 kilohertz AC signal on this, and the distance between these two probes electrodes are 1.1 meters fixed, and based on the response of this, they are getting the electrical conductivity of the soil. Now, you see in the bottom figure, you see when the topsoil depth is less, then less area of the probe is actually the sensing area. Whenever it is more, the more is the sensing area. So a correction factor is required. So from the topsoil depth, which they measured using the ultrasonic sensor, they corrected the electrical conductivity measurement, and they get the accurate electrical conductivity data from these measurements, from these two measurements. Now, this electrical conductivity data can be using artificial intelligence. They can map that what is the nitrogen content in this particular location, and accordingly, using a sprayer system, they can put that much amount of nitrogen. So simultaneously, during transplantation, they can apply nitrogen at a variable rate, at a required rate in the entire field. So this is how, at a very, very low cost, they can do it for the entire field. Now, I guess there is a requirement of second time application of nitrogen. Again, when the plant grows, after a few weeks or a few months, I don't know when it is required, but I guess that a second time fertilization is also required in rice cultivation. Okay. To do this, now we have plants grown in the field. So what they did, they tried to find out the chlorophyll content of the plants using some optical sensors. And chlorophyll content has direct correlation with nitrogen or leaf nitrogen. So using a optical sensor, it is possible to measure the leaf nitrogen content and to make a correlation of the demand of the soil, demand of nitrogen of the soil in that particular case. So what they did, they used a field vehicle, which is a high ground clearance field vehicle. Approximately the ground clearance is 1 meter, so that they can, the clearance is 1 meter, so that they can go on to, over the rice plants, and the width of the wheels are very, very thin. So this kind of field vehicle is available in Japan. So they take this type of field vehicle, and they put it into the field along with a optical sensor and sprayer. The two wings, you can see there are nozzles in various parts of the wings through which they can spray nitrogen fertilizer. This is the optical sensor, which is called CropSpec. This is from a company, Topcon. They have used these particular optical sensor. They uses pulsing laser diodes, they measure the plant reflectance from through which they will find out chlorophyll content as well as nitrogen. Two frequencies they use in the range of 740 nanometer and 810 nanometer. And from the figure bottom, you find that the viewing angle is 36 degree. So they can see the chlorophyll content or the nitrogen content of at the two sides of the vehicle, and they can also spray the nitrogen accordingly using the sprayers. So this is how they solve the problem without investing huge amount of sensor cost. This can be applied as a service, I mean service to different farmers, different fields. Okay, so need based application or variable rate application of fertilizer, they could do in a very, very intelligent manner. Finally, I will tell you about one of our ongoing projects, which is very, very similar to this, which started around a couple of years back. It is a 2 years project, and we are because of this pandemic situation, we are getting another 6 month extension to this project. This is a very, very similar project, which we have seen the example. Here, we are trying to build a autonomous field vehicle for paddy cultivation. Their vehicle was not autonomous, it was a human driven, but the vehicle we are trying to design is an autonomous field vehicle that will carry out different operations on the rice field. The idea is a farmer sitting at the comfort of his room, he can give command to the vehicle to follow a fixed path in the field and do certain operations. What can be the operations? The operations can be seeding, direct seeding variety of rice plantation. The operations can be spraying of pesticide. The operations can be disease detection, detection of pest infestation, detection of health, detection of growth of the plants. Based on that, fertilizer application, all these things. So this was our objective. And as we know that in Indian condition, the gap between two rows of plants is only 200 millimeter. We have made the wheels of the vehicle very, very thin, that is 60 millimeter. And we have a 70 millimeter error of margin at two ends. So our navigation has to be very, very precise. Since it is an autonomous navigation, it is a driverless vehicle. I am pleased to say that we using RTK GPS, which is an improved version of BGPS, which is called real-time kinematic GPS, we have achieved 10 millimeter accuracy in positioning. So we are sure that we will be able to navigate this kind of autonomous field vehicle through field. And this project we are carrying out with Bidsa Agricultural University. Because of pandemic, we are supposed to do the field trial in this month, but because of pandemic, I don't know when we'll be able to take it to field and try. I am showing you, this is the photograph of the field vehicle we have developed. It is, the ground clearance is 1.2 meter. It is fully autonomous. It can be remote controlled also. It has four wheels. All the four wheels are individually driven and steered so that it can follow an aux pattern in field. That means it can turn 90 degree on field. And we have put a onboard GPU based processor so that real time image processing can be done on field, and immediate actions can be taken. And we have put a huge battery which can so that it can be operated on field for 3 hours. This I have already mentioned what it can do. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, all of you. This is a post. This was a post lunch session, and
thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Any query I can raise it to you also.
The PPT WhatsApp so share karna sir.
Pardon.
No, sir.
Pardon.
Sir, PPT so WhatsApp share.
PPT karna. I will share with Professor Jha. I will share the PPT with Professor Jha.
Thank you, sir. Okay, thank you. Yeah, thank you Alakwesh ji, you have followed the time very well, and yes. I hope that the way you took the class must be beneficial to the participants. Once again, I thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So can I leave now?
Yes, you can leave now. Any participants have query?
Okay, there is no query, I think. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much, Professor Jha, and Manage, for giving me opportunity to speak here. Thank you very much, all of you. Bye bye.
Gujji sir, hello.
The training is over.
No, no, no. One more class is there. Dr. Gunji will take class because you all will say program schedule has already been circulated.
Okay.
So it will move as per plan. He's just joining.
Presentation to all the other. Jaa sahab.
Haha, okay. Welcome, sir. Welcome, Guji sahab. So participants are waiting for you.
Presentation to all the other.
And friends, you know very well that Sri Guji is a coordinator from managed side of this training program, and he will be taking class today on integration of digital services. So now it's over to you, Guji sahab. You start your presentation.
Make it presenter role.
Dr. Jha, permit him for uploading the presentation.
Jha sir, make it presenter role.
Dr. Jha, am I audible?
Yes. You are already host.
Yeah, this one. No. I joined as a normal user. Please make it presenter role.
Oh, Gunji Bhaskar. Okay. Let me check.
But your host is showing. Dr. Bhaskar, your host, it is showing here. You can upload.
Gunji Bhaskar. Okay, I am making a presenter.
Yeah, no, it's okay. Thank you. Okay, I think my presentation is visible to you.
Yeah, presentation is visible.
Okay. So good afternoon once again. In the morning we were discussing about the ICT's use in the extension services. So this is one like a case study, we can say. So Mainage is doing a collaborative projects in some of the areas. So one of the area also ICTs. Mainage and ZHZ is a German based organization. So ZHZ Mainage jointly we were implementing different projects for more than 6 to 7 years in the country. Presently, we are implementing one project called ProSoil in Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh in selected villages.